Let's hear it from our experts. So I would like to invite on the stage our panelists, Mr. Pushpesh Pant and Ms. Rashmi Bansal. Can we have a huge round of applause for them? Like I had just mentioned, Mr. Pushpesh Pant has been kind enough to join us for the third year now. He's had a teaching experience of 32 years. He's also a member, Executive Council of Kumaon University, Uttarakhand, an advisor to the Department of Culture and to the Steering Committee for Technological Mission Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. He has been advisor to the National Book Trust of India and Member Committee on Youth Tourism, Ministry of Tourism, Government of India. He's published widely on travel and tourism with over a dozen books to his credit. He's also scripted and anchored several food and travel TV shows. His book, India, The Cookbook, was named by the New York Times as one of the best cookbooks of the year. Let's hear it for him. And we have Ms. Rashmi Bansal, a writer, entrepreneur, and a youth expert. She's the author of 6 best-selling books on entrepreneurship that have sold more than 1 million copies and have been translated into 10 languages. She's also the founder of BGB Media, which is Bloody Good Book, a platform to discover and e-publish budding authors. Her first book, Stray Hungry, Stay Foolish, was a runaway bestseller on 25 MBA graduates from IIM Ahmedabad who went on to create successful businesses. She's also the co-founder of Just Another Magazine, which went on to become India's most popular youth magazine. Her popular blog, Youth Curry, features her writings on youth, career, and entrepreneurship. Let's also have a huge round of applause for her. I would now request Mr. Pushpesh Pant to take it forward from here. Thank you, sir.
Well, thank you very much for your kind words of welcome. I'm delighted, as usual, to be back in Bhuvaneshwar. As was mentioned, this is my third time here. It's almost like the current politicians.
Just a second, I think there's a problem with the mic.
I think there's a problem.
Maybe you can use that. I'll get one more.
Thank you very much, organizers. I'm very happy to be back. As was mentioned, this is my third time here. I enjoy being in Bhuvaneshwar, and I'm very happy that you called me once again. But frankly, I don't know what I'm doing here. I'm a bit confused, because this time I'm supposed to be in conversation with Rashmi on business writing in India. And we just had a wonderful session of storytelling, and I'm old-fashioned enough to believe that there is just writing. There is writing, there are stories, there are poems, there are plays. So what is this creature called business writing? Who's a business writer? And who's a reader of this thing? Is in business writing also there is an element like a Hindi masala film, a little bit of sex, a little bit of violence, a little bit of politics? And does it have the same attraction, the same seduction as a good play, a good novel, or a good short story has? But when I was trying to do this, I tried to read up for this session, and I was looking up what business writing is. And me and my dirty mind, I found out that Tim Cook of Apple had just come out of the closet and declared he was gay. So is that business writing part? How is it going to impact on the fortunes of Apple? Does it have something to do with the debate which we are having in this country about reading down by the Supreme Court, reading down by the Delhi High Court, getting it back by the Supreme Court about Section 377 Indian Penal Code? So I think the dividing line is very thin where business writing can claim to be a genre of its own. And what kind of a difference is there? Because it was said business writing in India, what are the opportunities, what are the difficulties, what are the problems? So I think we have got the best person to discuss these things with the audience today, because I think she may not like the comparison, but I think she is exactly what Chetan Bhagat is in fiction writing. Her books sell in almost into hundreds and thousands of copies of a single paperback. By now the damage has been done. I have run through half of my spiel in the beginning. But what I would like to begin with asking Rashmi is that what does she think business writing is? How is it different from general writing?
Thank you, Pushpesh. I'm delighted to be here. And I would like to just give my experience of business writing, which possibly could be different from what others have experienced. In a very simple nutshell, I think basically I'm also telling stories. So there is a kind of business writing where people write case studies, where people who attend business schools, we've all studied courses where we were given case studies, but I never found those interesting. I never found those exciting. They're as boring as history is for school students. So those case studies really distill whatever happens in business into numbers, figures, rational, logic, reasoning. I mean, it's very dry and it's very mind-focused, whereas I think the kind of business writing I do puts the human being at the center of the business, because every business is driven by a human being, by the qualities of that human being, by his aspirations, his or her aspirations and dreams. So the kind of writing I do is a little unusual in business, because generally in business emotions don't seem to have a place. But in my books, emotions are very important too, because they lead to certain decisions. Even the decision to start a business, it comes from a very deep passion or desire to do something different. So somewhere there is emotional quotient in business.
Hello.
And that's where my books differ from a lot of business books, which chronicle what a business is doing. They look at it in a very factual way. So, I mean, each kind of writing has its own place, but my kind of writing is the one which marries business with the human being.
No, I mean, you have put it very well, because I was reading one of your stories in one of the books you are good enough to give me. This is about the founder of the Crossword Bookstore. So there is the passion of this person, Kitabi Kida, to find a bookstore. He has an attachment with a partner who's with him. He has some apprehensions and fears about how the store will do. There are a bit of heartbreaks and disappointments, and they move on. So there are those essential elements of a story. There is romance, there is some fear, some apprehension, some struggle, some dreaming. So this probably would be the common factor. And I was about to say that this is what Chetan Bhagat does in his paperbacks, which have a ready appeal for the younger generation. So he's doing it in fiction, and you are writing what is not obviously fiction, but there is truth in them. The stories are real life case studies, but they are not the case studies which you studied when you were at IMM. But that's where my confusion is, that there was business writing in India before Rashmi Bansal. There were people who wrote biographies of great industrialists. They did institutional histories, corporate histories. Some people have done sensational scoops and scandals which have happened. Two recent stories like the gas wars by Paranjya Guha Thakurta, or maybe the Sahara story. So you have stories which talk of sleaze, who talk of maybe not sex overtly like that, but not like Tim Cook coming out and saying, I'm different. But people start thinking about that business writing is not so different from their own lives. Now, I'm tempted to ask you this question, because you yourself have gone through IMM Ahmedabad. You were not very happy with the case studies which you did, so you have created, sort of speaking, case studies of your own. And the reach of your books is fantastic. You have a first book, which was the initial bestseller, which deals with success stories of IMM graduates. You have a follow-up book which deals of totally different people who have not been to IMM at all. So it's like what Harvard Business School doesn't teach you. The third book is Power of a Dream, people who are working in the social sector. Then you have other books. So, but what I would like to ask you is that had you not gone to IMM, would you still have chosen to be a business writer? And what did you do before you became a full-time business writer? Because you still have a incestuous umbilical relationship with business. You are a IMM graduate. You probably were in corporate sector before. So you drifted towards business writing, or you were drawn towards business writing, and your readers maybe primarily are those who are doing management courses, who are young executives, who want to aspire to what Amin Bhai said in post-Manmohan Singh India, careers have opened up for enterprise, for entrepreneurship, for self-employment, and so on. So how much of this is a self-help book, and how much of this is a hardcore business book?
So my second book is called Connect the Dots, and even this phrase is taken from a speech that Steve Jobs gave at Stanford University, where he exhorted the graduates to stay hungry, stay foolish. And the essence of this line is that, you can never make sense of your life until you look backwards and connect the dots. So, when my first book released, I could actually look back and connect the dots of everything that happened. Because I wanted to be a journalist. I started writing when I was a student in college. I started freelancing for different newspapers. More than 100 of my articles were published. But being from a middle class family, I had promised my father that, okay, engineering nahi kiya, medicine nahi kiya, toh okay, I will try for MBA. So I gave the CAT exam and I got admission. And then I thought, let me see what is this MBA course. So I went very unwillingly to IIM Ahmedabad. One of the big attractions was I'll get to stay in a hostel away from my parents. So I didn't really go there with the objective of, getting a plum job. I thought it'll be a great experience for me. Yes, at the end of it, it was something which changed my life. It changed my thinking. It exposed me to so many new ideas, wonderful people. But I went back to journalism. I went and worked with Times of India for 2 years. Then I started my own company. I became an entrepreneur. I published a youth magazine called Jam. So when I actually wrote this book, Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish, I brought all those things together into one project. The fact that I have been an entrepreneur, I've been a writer. So when I went to interview people for this book, I did not go as a journalist. I didn't go as an outsider. I could understand the struggle they had been through. They could relate to me. They were very open and honest. Usually, kya hota hai, if a journalist goes and wants to interview a businessman, that person tries to only project the good part of the story. It's more like a public relations exercise where they try to, highlight their achievements. Whereas I went to them saying that, look, this book, we want to use it to educate young people that what is entrepreneurship. They shouldn't be misled. They shouldn't feel that, oh, it's a bed of roses. It is very difficult. So I want you to share with me ups and downs of your journey. Just don't tell me the good parts. You have to tell me some of the struggles you faced. So I think every person has a certain, God has given each of us certain unique qualities and certain, inclination. I could have very well gone into the conventional jobs which people took up, but then I wouldn't be sitting here today. So my journey culminated in this point where I started writing these books. The first book, it was not meant to be released in the market. We only were to release it at a conference organized by IIM Ahmedabad, where we were to print 1,000 copies and give it free to the students. Just thinking that, maybe some of our students will get inspired to become entrepreneurs. But when the book was released, everyone loved it and said, why don't we produce 5,000 copies and, put it in the market. And that's how this, book actually reached the public. And once it went in the market, the kind of response it got was very different from what, books get. Because I remember the first email I got saying that, I read your book and I quit my job. So a person wrote this. I said, my God, is this like possible? And then I realized it's like, everybody has a dream. And sometimes when you read a book like this, you realize that the people who've done it are no different from you. So you're able to relate to it and you're able to kind of, the book acts like little matchstick. So it was not intended as a, necessarily as a self-help book, but that's how people received it. So I have written it, I think, in terms of as a business book, the facts and the, the details of the business are important. But the packaging is such that people can relate to it. My mother has read the books. My daughter, who's in, ninth standard, her friends have read the books. So it was never intended as a book for MBA students. It was.
Would I be right in saying that when you talk in terms of business writing, you are talking of the business of living? So what you are writing is helping your readers to get ahead with the business of living, not necessarily running a dhanda. you are providing them points of success, formulae for getting over their bottlenecks and so on. They could be MBA graduates, they could be self-employed entrepreneurs, they could be working in a social sector, non-profit sector, and still there would be skills which everybody could use. Would that be the idea?
Yeah, I mean, when you say it like that, I feel, yes, this is what I've done. But I never had this clarity when I was doing the books. When I did the books, I thought that, you know, I looked at the first book as an opportunity for myself, that I'll get to meet these 25 very interesting people, and I'll get to learn something from them. And everybody else is not getting this chance, so I will share what I learned with all of you through the book. And that's what I did. I think the difference between my style of writing and other business writers is that possibly a person who comes from a business journalism background looks at, is very skeptical and cynical in their approach towards writing. And they won't really look for the lessons that you can learn, you know, from a successful person or from a person whom you admire. So that's really not their goal. Their goal is more to document what has happened in the business, in the entrepreneur's life, but not to look at the quotient of how it can help people. Whereas in my mind, it was, because for me itself, it was a learning exercise. I wanted to share that with others. But having said that, I think the difference also is that mine was the first book which started, you know, put a focus on first generation entrepreneurs. Because prior to that, we had a lot of books in India, but they were about Birlas, Tatas, Ambanis. So when you read the life story of, say, Dhirubhai Ambani, it's very inspiring. But most people feel that, okay, he was a great man and I can't possibly be like him. So he's a unique and special person, and okay, he's a person one can admire, but I cannot be like him. Whereas when you read these stories of 20 people, and you know, somebody's father is working in State Bank of India, somebody is born in your hometown, somebody is from your school, so you feel this person is like me, and therefore maybe, you know, I too don't come from a business family, I don't come from a business community, so I could also do something which I've wanted to do. So I think, again, I would not take credit for it. I'm saying accidentally I stumbled upon a sort of a need that was there among people to believe in themselves.
No,
and
I think
something.
You have given me an opening to talk about my book selfishly and plug myself. You said you stumbled into this opportunity to write about business writing and took a road which was not taken by others before. Somebody asked me to write a collection of recipes, and I did that. Before that, I had been, incidentally, my biodata is slightly outdated here. I did not teach for 32 years in JNU. I taught for 42 years. Obviously, I have forgotten to update that on the net, and the organizers haven't had the benefit of that. But the point is that I taught 40 years international relations and Indian politics. And then some friend said, why don't you write a recipe book? I was interested in food. I'm gluttonous. The only two things I'm interested are food and sex, in the reverse order, as I said last time. And I decided to write the book. Nobody asked me to read the modern Kama Sutra, so I had to do that. But talking of food and sex relationship, I can't get it out of my system. Partly the audience would remember that. Vikas Khanna is writing a recipe book, and he calls it the Kama Sutra, not the Kama Khazana. So he's working on Vatsyayana's title. So I was wondering that some of the books which you have written also have very interesting titles, like I Have a Dream, Connecting the Dots, Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish. All three come from American folklore. Two from Steve Jobs, one Martin Luther King, partly repeated by Rajiv Gandhi, I Too Have a Dream. And then also Mr. Modi during his election campaign, talking of his dreams and India's dream. And so I think these are more or less stock phrases which come in handy in any kind of communication skill. But to get back to my experience of accidentally stumbling into this recipe book, it turned out to be a very successful book. It made me a lot of money. It allowed me the luxury of taking premature retirement and doing whole time on food. But the point is that, again, what is the readership of that book? At one level, it leaves me dissatisfied. New York Times ranked it number one. It has had an uninterrupted popularity on Amazon, 5 stars, 4.5 stars across 4 years, translated into German, Dutch, etc. But I, as an Indian author, interested in food, am extremely unhappy. I see Mr. Qureshi sitting in the front row, who has done a delightful, mouth-watering, drooling book on food of old lady. Now, that is the kind of book I would have liked to write, which tells about old vessels, which evokes the smells, the taste, the flavors. What happened in London, because they thought the reader wanted a different book, it became a collection of 1,000 recipes with 8 pages of introduction, telegraphically written for a foreign NRI audience. I'm still waiting to fulfill my dream of writing a book on an all India canvas or something of that kind, which evokes a period, a time, etc. Now again, the story session before this and the conversation which we are having is leading directly to the new generation, post-liberalization generation. And the two of us belong certainly not to that generation at all. So when we are communicating, I enjoyed reading what little I did of your book. But I had a few problems with that. I wouldn't mind something like which the English historian said, English politician told the painter, you paint me warts and all. So when you do these inspirational business stories, or when I do a recipe book for a foreign audience, we make our money, we give our good reviews, we get invitations to talk like this, but something remains unfulfilled. Would you have much rather written a business book, substantial, not necessarily a biography, but bringing up the negative elements, not necessarily being constrained about inspiring people? Now people say, what a great book you have written, Dr. Pant. I know that's not true. I'm really fond of the other book, which, I mean, permit me 130 seconds more. I will plug my other book, which is the book about dhabas from Kabul to Calcutta. I did not get a visa to go to Pakistan, but this book was much more fun to write because I could write about food I had eaten, say this bad. I could talk about dhabas, the places and so on. So do you at times feel that the success becomes a constraint? You keep replicating the successful model, like I hate to bring in Mr. Bhagat again. You keep writing books which will sell into hundreds of thousands of copies. Everybody wants to make the same box office film hit. But you are very successful, obviously. These are translated, I believe, into 10 Indian languages. They are selling brilliantly. But do you at times feel that you would also like to write something differently in this field?
See, I believe in the books I'm writing, and that's why I write them. I mean, no one's forcing me to write them. Yes, you are right. To an extent, one is guided by what people want. But if I look at the progress I made in writing these books, like my most recent book, Take Me Home, it's about entrepreneurs from small towns of India. And why I wrote this book is because when I used to go to colleges in smaller towns, I felt those students feel, you know, they can't maybe relate to the people I've featured in a book like Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish, because they're not going to go to IIM. They're going to say, look, I'm in Bhuvaneshwar. Bhuvaneshwar mein ye sab nahi hota hai. It's not possible. I have to go to Bombay, I have to go to Delhi. Then only I'll be able to do something meaningful in life. So to an extent, my books are driven by the fact that there are amazing stories in our country. We are a country of 1 billion people. And every year I can surely find 20 or 25 interesting people to write about. But I try to choose themes which I haven't done before. Like I did a book on women entrepreneurs, which is about women who have raised a family and run a business. Because, you know, we usually, when we talk about women entrepreneurs in India, we have only one name which comes to mind, which is Kiran Mazumdar Shaw. But when I look at her life, I mean, I admire her greatly, but I feel that, you know, she didn't have any children. So her journey is different from that of the average Indian woman. So I've tried to pick themes which are not necessarily the most popular. I mean, I could sell more copies if I just did another book on IIT people who have, done great things in life. In India, these things sell, IIT, IIM, vagera, vagera. But I always try to, in my mind, do something I haven't done before. You know, to look at a theme which I haven't done before. The format is similar, but the themes are different. Of course, every writer does have an urge to do something they have never done before, because that's a challenge. Like if I were to take up a completely new project, then yes, I would be pushing myself to do something that is difficult for me. So I do have such plans to write such books also, maybe, you know, even do a book of fiction. But currently I have so many stories to tell and so many interesting stories to tell that I have at least 4 to 5 books more I want to write in this series.
All right. Yeah. Now you have stories to tell, and I have a question to ask. The question is, it directly relates to what happened just before we came onto the dais. Amin Bhai was telling stories brilliantly and keeping the audience regaled, young and old alike. He began with English, lapsed into Hindustani and then was bilingual most, and he was using sign language and body language brilliantly. Now, body language is not a luxury available to you or I. Now, when you are having stories to tell and you have youngsters to address, you have a problem of language. So you have books being translated, and what I have in mind is something specific. Like the titles of your books are so evocative. I Have a Dream, Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish, Take Me Home, Coming Back from Country Music. When you, much is lost in translation. Now, if you are being translated into Indian language, how do you cope with the problem of lost in translation? Because if you are literate in English and are exposed to English medium education, you can see, I mean, I can imagine if this storytelling session had taken place in a, I mean, he must, I mean, bhai obviously makes amends and he says he goes to schools, underprivileged children, different children. But had it been into the heartland of Bihar or UP, Chhattisgarh or Jharkhand, where even Hindi is a foreign language. I have had this experience when I was talking in Hindi in Patna. Somebody said, why do you want to impose Hindi on us? Because now they want to move up globalization, English. And they said, I said, but your mother tongue is Hindi. He said, no, my mother tongue is Bhojpuri. My mother tongue is Magahi. My mother tongue is Maithili. In Rajasthan, it is something else, a dialect. So I think where we have strong linguistic affinities, and the youngest generation, which has not had the benefit of English medium education, doesn't relate subliminally to these evocative phrases. How do you ensure that your book is translated where the content retains its fidelity?
Well, first of all, majority of my books are read in English. The reason being that my target audience is young people, and for them, English is an aspirational language. So generally, often I get emails from students saying that, you know, I need advice about my career, C-A-R-R-I-E-R. And the entire, you know, paragraph they've written is full of mistakes. But, you know, the content is still something that you can understand. So, possibly I wonder, how do they read my books? But then, I think they are able to understand it. And they're able to, maybe, many of them say that, this is one of the only books I've read outside my school syllabus. You know, otherwise I'm forced to read books which are given to us in school, but I never read books. So most of my books, I think the appeal is in English. And I have been accused of not writing in English because my books also include some Hindi phrases. Because as a writer, I feel there are many, many words which do not translate well into English. Like suppose I try to translate the word junoon. You know, junoon, I don't know if there is an equivalent of junoon in English, which has the exact same meaning, or a word like jugaad, or even certain phrases, because there are people who talk to me when I interview them, they give me the entire interview in Hindi, because that's the language they're more comfortable
in. I'm very glad you mentioned the word jugaad, because I think that was a very interesting book. Title Jugaad, published by LF, which dealt with the Indian business mind.
So what I do is, in any case, my books are accessible to people who are not even that well versed in English. They don't have to be, extremely sort of intelligent or, you know, well versed in the language to read my books. And the second thing is that, yes, translation is an issue. But for example, in Gujarati, we have a very good translator called Sonal Modi, who does an excellent job. She even changes the titles of the book to Gujarati, you know, phrase in Gujarati. Like the book Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish in Gujarati is called Khabe Pothro Ne Desh Mokdo. It means something in Gujarati, which is basically, young man, pick up your bags and go and find your fortune. And those books do extremely well, and we are lucky to get such translators in some languages. Gujarati books sell the most out of all the translated books. But it may not be possible in every language, but still there is a value, because some people who may not be able to read English, they are able to read the books. So ideally, yes, I would like to have somebody like Sonal Modi working with me in every language, you know, to take the books to every student who might want to read it, whether or not they know English. And thirdly, I would just say that I myself am inspired a lot by American writers, because I spent a few years of my childhood in America. Since my father was a scientist, we lived there. And I find that American writers have a very simple and direct way of conveying what their thoughts are. Whereas probably the classical literature, which is based in Britain, and I did study literature in college. That is, uses more flowery language, it uses difficult English, it uses, you know, a different, it has a different sensibility, which I don't relate to. And there are three authors in particular among, you know, American business writers whom I admire a lot. One of them is Malcolm Gladwell, because, you know, he can take a very complex subject, he can take research done by professors in universities, and he can take the essence of it and convey it like a story. So when I first started writing Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish, I mean, he was my idol, that, you know, if I could write like him, because, you know, the kind of impact his books have on me, I would want to be able to have that impact on others. Another author is Poe Bronson. So he actually wrote a book called What Should I Do With My Life, which I read around in the year 2004. And what he did was he interviewed about, I don't know, about 500 people, and finally he put the stories of 50 people who answered this question, what should I do with my life? And each one had a different answer. So it was done very beautifully. And a third author whom I really admire is called Michael Lewis. So he's written a series of books about Wall Street. He was himself a trader on Wall Street, and then he wrote a book. His most recent book is called, it's about high-speed trading on Wall Street. It's called Flash Boys. So he's taken, again, a very complex subject and made it simple and easy for you and me to understand.
Can I interrupt, if you allow me? Because I greatly appreciate your sources of inspiration, but I would say that would you be also able to enlighten us about some of the contemporary business writers in India with strong business roots, somebody like a different generation Guru Saran Das, somebody like Paranja Guha Thakurta, and you started your career with a newspaper, and there are a sets of pink newspapers which are devoted to business writing, and you have business magazines where you were a consulting editor, contributing editor at one stage. So how would you relate the state of the art of business writing in India, moving away from your own work, and having a critical look, not necessarily at rivals, but other practitioners of the art at the moment and what they are facing? Because you see, I recall reading some early books like Mr. Lala on Tatas. I recall reading some books like Vinay Bharatram writing about his own family back from the brink, the bankruptcy story, and back from disaster of DCM. You have other people either giving adulatory accounts or critical accounts or sensational scoops, and you have these works. You have Jan Timberjan on Marwadis, who talks about Parta Khata. You have Jaju writing of his benefactor mentor G.D. Birla at one stage. You have authorized and unauthorized biographies, not only of Steve Jobs in America, but of Indian industrialists, including Dhirubhai Ambani and Sahara Shree. So there is interest of a general reader in a business book because it has a spillover. You say, oh, Radia was given a Jaguar by Mr. Tata. So was there a relationship? Why was it done? Barkhadat comes out in the Radia tape, so people read for sleaze, people read for scandal, and then they see that the business writing book has a spillover into their daily lives. So whether it is the CAG, the Colgate, whether Kiss and Tell, it was the session was yesterday, and I believe you were there, sir. But I think whether it is Parak writing a book, whether it is Mr. Vinod Rai writing a book, they also skate on thin ice and maybe writing about political subjects, but they encroach on the territory of business activities so intensely that when you are talking of the newspapers or the business world columns, business magazine columns, maybe a ground is prepared and seeding is being done for your kind of books.
Yeah, I have heard of many of these books, but honestly, I haven't read them. Like, I have heard about Mr. Lala's books. I've heard of Geeta Piramal's books. But I, as a reader, never felt attracted to reading them because I felt that these are about these old business families. And
no, but what about something like Guru Saran Das's India Unbound? He belongs to a different generation. I mean, I could go back
no,
even
I,
earlier.
I agree.
To Prakash Tandon in the Punjabi Century.
I have personally not read them, so I can't comment because, again, I may have read excerpts in newspapers and magazines. Yes, I have read a lot of business newspapers and magazines. I do keep up with that. I think one book which I've read is Devdutt Patnaik Business Sutra, which I really enjoyed because that talked about how, you know, Indian philosophy of management is different from Western management philosophy. You know, the whole Indian way of life is not.
But is it? The problem, pardon my interruption, I mean, I have a dirty habit of interrupting at the wrong time. But my problem with Dr. Patnaik is that he is a convenient niche slot for himself, which is advising Indian business about Indian business ethics, mythology, culture. But the way we are talking, the present Indian population, which Mr. Qureshi had the honor of leading to various elections, is between the ages of 18 and 30. Does it have the same mindset about mythology and the business which the Marwadi 70-year-old Padta Khata system was there? Does the youngster who is aspirational, wants to go to America, wants to believe in Jugaad technology? So the between Jugaad and myth versus Mithya, and rereading Ramayana and Mahabharata everywhere from Supreme Court to Parliament that observe the Lakshmana Rekha, they are convenient clichetic forms. Does the Indian youngster have any clue, or is he even literate about mythology at all? Or he has Amar Chitrakatha version of mythology, which Dr. Devdutt Patnaik, a medical doctor, has found it convenient to encapsulate and sell very conveniently to a niche audience. It is not shared by the rest of the Indian readership.
I can only speak for myself that I found Business Sutra to be a very interesting book with food for thought, because you see, we have borrowed the entire concept of management from Harvard Business School, whereas the Indian way of doing business and Indian way of living is different. So this was the first author I found who actually had, you know, written something on this subject. Now we may debate whether what he's written is true or whether it's applicable, but certainly it was a very interesting book. But I have personally not found that. I feel business writing is evolving in India because business itself is a recent phenomenon. Till 1991, I don't think, you know, business was an area where most Indians would like to venture into. It was the preserve of a few families. It was known to be dirty. It was known to be something that you had to do if you had certain qualities. If you wanted to be an honest, hardworking businessman, that was really not an option for you before 1991. So if you really look at the history of business before 91, it's totally different from after 91. And I think it will take time, because today most of the business writing in India is, it cannot be very truthful, because today if somebody writes a very truthful biography of a very well-known businessman, probably that person will go to court and say, you know, please put an injunction on this book. So it's very difficult to publish the kind of books which actually get published in America, unauthorized books or authorized books. Even a book like Steve Jobs' biography, you know, he told the biographer that, look, you are free to write whatever you want. Do not come and ask me, show me, or consult me. Okay, this is my legacy, but I trust you. I've selected you. I think you'll do a fair job. And the way he's written that book, it's, you can't say that he's praising Steve Jobs only. I mean, he's looked at his weaknesses, he's looked at his faults, he's criticized him. So that kind of book, it will take time to evolve and happen in India, because if someone is courageous enough to write it, that book will get banned. Already certain books like polyester prints are not available in India. They are not, you know, probably you can buy them on internet. So I think just conclude that, you know, there is always space for...
I'm
just saying that there is space for many more business writers to come in. I don't personally see myself as a business writer. I say business, as you said, is a part of life. I look at myself more as a person who's enabling people to understand that business can be done by anybody. And, you know, if you have a dream, you can make it happen, because a lot of other people like you have done it. It's business is not in our genes. I mean, it's not that I have to be born a Marwadi Jain or, you know, business caste person and only then I can do business. So, I mean...
Well, I think we have been talking enough. I think we should throw the floor open to the audience now so we can have questions.
Two of the iconic geniuses are sitting on the stage and very erudite audience. I want to share two concerns here. First is regarding the title of Rashmi Bansal's very epoch-making book, Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish. One correction, that Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish was never said by Steve Jobs. He has himself admitted. If you very carefully go through that Stanford address, you'll find Steve Jobs never said, I said that it is Stay Hungry, Stay Foolish. He has written There are a group of very young iconic writers who were writing a magazine, some sort of National Geographic. Then they found its magazine is not selling well. They wanted to stop that issue. And in the closing issue, in the editorial, they wrote that we have tried our level best to keep up this magazine. And we hope the next generation will carry it forward. And in the ending line, they wrote, stay hungry, stay foolish. The line was very much liked by Steve Jobs. He quoted it.
Very much like Steve Jobs, sir. He's not known for originality. He went to the Xerox lab, and the rest is history, as you read the biography.
Not to blame Steve Jobs, he has never also said that I have said this. Another fundamental error in many of the business writings you see, the State Bank of India is also writing it. Customer is the most important visitor in the premises of any organization. We write Mahatma Gandhi.
Absolutely.
And you'll be surprised, Mahatma Gandhi never said this. I want to thank you, sir. Yes.
Because many people tell me I've stolen this line from Steve Jobs. I said it's just inspired by Steve Jobs, but
in management classes when I say, who said Steve Jobs, who said stay hungry, stay foolish, students say Rashmi Bansal. So that is how we catch up when the books get glamorized, the truth remains behind. Another fact is that Gandhi has never said customer is the most important visitor in the premises of any organization. It was said by a British businessman called L.L. Bean. The company was L.L. Bean & Co. He said customer is the most important visitor in the premises of any organization. He is not an interruption to our work. He is the purpose of it. We are not doing a favor by serving him. Rather, he is doing so by allowing us to do so. Gandhi never admitted that he said this. But only thing was there was no internet. We could not know that whether Gandhi has said this or somebody other.
Pardon my interruption, the purpose is not to prove the authenticity of the original quotation. If you go back to the house divided against itself, cannot stand or fall, Abraham Lincoln, has been traced back all the way to Old Testament in Bible.
Yes, sir.
So there is an old shlok by Bhavbhuti in Uttar Ramcharit, which says, Kalo chayam anirvadhir vipulashta prithvi utpatsate mamakopi samana dharma. The earth is vast, time is ever flowing, somebody somewhere will have similar thoughts. Let's not get into this quarrel.
Opinion to Rashmi, madam. One thing is that the anecdotes sometimes never work in some different context. We sometimes quote American anecdotes which never work. The best example is that monkey story. The cap seller, the person who was selling hats, slept under the tree. The monkey stole all the hats, and then he threw one and others threw it. 20 years after, the hat seller's son came to the same tree, slept under the tree. Uska topi sab bandar le gaye. Phir usko malum tha ki pitaji story bole hain. Kuch parwaah nahi, kuch chinta nahi hai. To wo apna hat fek diya, ek bhi bandar nahi feka. Ek chota sa bandar dod ke aaya, ek zor se chanta mara aur bola, do you think your father has only told you the story?
Hello, ma'am. Ma'am, what makes you to use the eye-catchy lines like Jugaad Junoon Kitabi Keeda and like Catch a Man to Fish in your book? Is it for the business only, or it is the target is for the young people to have a look on the book?
This is my style of writing. I write simple language, and I feel that phrase is appropriate, so I use it. I don't know Urdu, I don't know, you know, those other very hi-fi kind of phrases to use. When I write a story, I think what should be the title, and then what comes to my mind, I put it. And I'm happy it appeals to young people. I have worked with young people for a long time. I was editor of a youth magazine. I myself wrote for a lot of youth magazines. So I know that, you know, we don't really today want things which we cannot relate to. So somewhere my style of writing is like that. It comes naturally to me. I don't think and I don't do a strategy that how I will write that. It just comes.
Thank you.
Yeah, my question is to Rashmi. I begin by confessing my ignorance, number one. You seem to have struck upon an excellent formula of telling the stories of successful people. So now, I suppose that business writing is pretty new in India. Is that right? I suppose business writing is new in India. I mean, the kind of successful stuff.
I'm sorry, I can't understand.
I said, is business writing new in India?
Illuminating.
New in India. Yeah.
No, I think business writing has been, there have been many business writers before me. I'm not the first. But
okay.
they had a different style of writing and they focused on different kinds of businessmen.
Okay, now I'm taking this forward, right? Now, you have books like Jeffrey Archer. You have books like Wall Street, which are fictional business writing. Do you see that happening? Are you planning to do something like that? Or do you think it's going to work here?
You mean, will I write fiction based on business?
Yeah.
Anything can happen. I don't know. Someday, there are many stories which I feel possibly I can't put them as the truth. And they have lots of twists and turns which, are pretty interesting. Maybe I'll combine all of them and make a fiction out of it.
No, but you seem to have struck an excellent formula to sell. So do you think that's going to be a formula to sell? Do you think that'll work as a saleable formula?
See, there's nothing called a formula to sell because the moment you do it with your rational mind, it doesn't work. If you write it with your heart and you really believe it, then it sells. So if there is somebody out there who really is able to do that, it'll work. But if they approach it like, with an Excel sheet, it's not going to work.
I don't agree with you.
My question is to Rashmi, ma'am. Ma'am, this side. Hello, ma'am. Your work is so simple to understand. Just like when I read Chetan Bhagat, I can relate. But now I hate him, his work. But Rao, what you're writing is kind of redundant, even if you're changing themes. But with the popularity you have, you can work on, I just think that you can work on financial literacy campaign. Maybe you can create awareness on how to handle money. Or maybe you can work on this financial inclusion. You have any plans such?
Well, I don't have plans to do the specific things that you say. The thing is that each person has certain things they're attracted to. So perhaps if you feel strongly about it, you start something. I personally am not very much. Each one has to find something they want to do. Yes, maybe some of you have read many of my books and you feel you've heard it before. That's fair. Sometimes I read 5 books by an author and then I don't like the 6th book. So, but the thing is, our country is a vast country and there are so many people out there. And the next book I'm writing, for example, which is coming in January, it's about student entrepreneurs. It's about people who've started a company while they're studying in college. And I thought of doing this book because everybody knows that in US, Facebook was started in a dormitory of Harvard, university. So are there such people in India? And I go to so many colleges to give talks and in the hall, everyone is sitting blankly. And then they say, ma'am, I will finish my graduation and then I will decide what to do in life. I said, that is already too late. You're sitting in a college today, 3 years, your parents have paid the fees, you have free internet, you have free labor force with your friends and all of you around. Can you at least think of earning 50,000 rupees pocket money instead of taking everything from your parents? Have you ever thought that, okay, I do some small business, I do some small creative activity and I earn some money of my own? So every book I write, I do it because I feel attracted to that subject. I feel that it will also be of interest to certain group of people out there. So if I feel one day that, yes, financial literacy is that subject, I'll do it. But
it's like Kiyosaki.
It may not happen. I mean, I get so many suggestions and I am very happy to hear them. But unless I feel that, yes, mujhe ye karna hai, then I have to devote like 1 year of my life to that. So if I get the feeling that that subject is important enough for me, then I go ahead and do it. But what I would say is that if you feel strongly about something, you do something in a small way in your own college, in your own community, But thank you for your suggestion.
Ma'am, and one simple question. Even Napoleon Hill did the same work. He also analyzed different industries during his contemporary time, and he wrote the book Think and Grow Rich, I guess. So, can you compare your work with him because you're also doing the same kind of work?
I can't understand what you're saying.
Have you read Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich? because in that book, even he took, means he actually documented the key points, how they have grown from humble, means they were humble and they have grown.
What is the name of the book?
Think and Grow Rich.
Yes, of course. I mean, see, Napoleon Hill is the father of all the books today which are called self-help books. I mean, it's a wonderful book, and it's written in a different way than my books, and that's a, you know, a different style of writing, and I love his books. I think he's a, you know, very big inspiration, and I think today probably those books are even out of copyright and you can just like download them free and read them. So I always recommend his books. After reading my books, when people ask what should I read, I say please read Napoleon Hill. There is also a book called Success Through a Positive Mental Attitude. It's a wonderful book, you know. It explains in more detail. Like in my books, it's stories, so you have to get the lesson by reading the story. But American style of writing is that they like give you the prescription. Aisa karo, aisa karo, aisa karo, to aapko ye milega. And that's also a good way. So those books are very good. You should read them.
Yeah, hello, ma'am. I've read all your books, and especially I like the one on women entrepreneurs. My question to you is that you graduated from IIM Ahmedabad, and you must have seen your peers and colleagues sitting for placements and going to get jobs. So I would like to know some personal experiences during that time. It's very stressful. What were you thinking, that what you want to do, or can you share something about that time?
Yeah, I did my summer training at a company called Lintas. It was an advertising agency. And people told me, you know, advertising agencies, they're a very creative job, so maybe you'll like that. So I went there, and for 2 months, I was doing a survey on Ariel and Surf Ultra washing powder. Okay, so I used to go door to door to get the survey response. Nobody wanted to talk to me. All the ladies are busy in the housework, you know. I used to get 2 surveys filled in a day. Then I said, what to do? So one day I just went to Churchgate station. I took a train ticket. I sat in the train. And then the whole day I would just go up and down the train. I would ask this lady, where are you getting down? In Bombay, we always ask, aap kidhar utar rahe ho? They'll tell me, okay, I'm getting down in Bandra. So means aadha ghanta hai. So those days people didn't have phones, you know, they were not busy. They were like happy to talk to you. So that way I completed this survey of 400 housewives. And at the end of it, I said, oh, I can't spend my life doing this, whether this powder washes brighter clothes, whiter clothes, hands. Matlab, if this is what I have to put my life, you know, if this is what I have to make my life's work, I mean, anybody can do this job. I mean, it's a good job, but it's not something I want to do in my life. So I'm very grateful to this company for giving me this job, because at the end of it, I realized that this is not the job for me, and it made my life very clear that, look, if I want to be a writer, I have to be a writer. I can't take a job as a soap and detergent marketing manager and side by side do writing. At least I felt that's not possible for me, because like my whole life will get drained doing this job, and then I'm going to go home and just watch TV and go to sleep. So this was one experience which helped me a lot to realize that, you know, probably corporate job is not for me.
Thank you. It's been wonderful
talking
to you.
Last question. I have a question, please. This is, since it's the literature festival, I'm asking to all luminaries here that because of the social media, I think the language is getting distorted. Is it in the long run correct?
Well, language is always changing and growing and developing. So in the short run, we might feel that language is getting destroyed, but somewhere there is a balance which is maintained. Some new words will come in, some change will be there in behavior of people. I think people's attention span has fallen. So maybe that is one aspect we have to think about. Maybe in future, there will be more readers on tablets and mobile phones and in e-book format, you know, rather than printed books. So all this is going to happen, and we will have to go with the flow. You know, we can't stop it. We can't say, oh, this is bad and we don't want to be part of it. So this is all a part of life, and we have to adjust and we have to make the best of it. And we have to still retain what is important to us. Each one has that option. If you don't want to use that kind of language in social media, don't use it. you know, still follow what you feel is correct.
No, I think I must thank you this time from the depth of my heart, and finally, this is the final thank you, no more questions. Thank you. It's been wonderful talking to you, Rashmi.
Well, I have an announcement here. For all the school and college students who are here with us right now, I'm sure you all are acquainted with selfies, clicking selfies and hosting on Facebook and Twitter. Are you, can I hear those sitting at, you all are, right? Okay, so now there's a little contest for you. You can click pictures of this festival, as innovative and interesting you can get. And the best picture will be published in, you know, you have to tweet the photo and tag the official Twitter handles of the New Indian Express and Mr. Prabhu Chawla. And the best photograph will be published in the City Express Bhuvaneshwar edition with your photograph as well. So, you know, start clicking. Okay, that was the announcement for the school and college students. May I now request the editorial director of the New Indian Express, Mr. Prabhu Chawla, to please come on stage and present mementos to our esteemed panelists. All right, we'll take a short break of 40 minutes and please come back because we have a very interesting session ahead, writing for a visual medium. So I want all of you to join us in a short while. Thank you. And students, you can start clicking whichever way you want to and start hosting it on Twitter.